very good morning, students. Welcome to Science Section for Class Review. And today we are going to see the 20th of the session on animals. Now here in this session, we will be learning about the human digestive system, excretory system, and reproductive system. We are going to learn about the various parts of the alimentary canal, the process of digesting, what is the role of enzymes in the process of digesting, and the organs that are involved in the excretory system and the A very good morning, students. Welcome to science session for class 9, and today we are going to see unit 20, organ system in animals. Now here in this lesson we will be learning about the human digestive system, excretory system, and reproductive system. We are going to learn about the various parts of the alimentary canal, the process of digestion, what is the role of enzymes in the process of digestion, and the organs that is involved in the excretory system and the reproductive system. What is the role of skin in excretion? And here we are going to learn about the functions of the male and the female human reproductive system. Let's go into the session, children. Now you know very well that the organ level of organization is present in the human body, isn't it? So the complex level of organization that is present in the human body, and we know very well that the cells are the basic fundamental units of the organ system, and these cells are grouped together to form the tissues, tissues into the organs, and two or more organs work together to form the organ system and perform functions like digestion, circulation, transmission of the impulse from one place to the other, and also in the excretion process. So these are the various types of the organ system that takes place in the human body, isn't it? Now here we are going to learn about the digestive system, excretory system, reproductive system in the human beings. Now look into the tabular columns, children. Here you have the various system, that is organ system, and the organs that is involved in each of the system and their functions. Now the first one is the integumentary system. So that is the outermost skin, isn't it? So this consists of the organs, that is skin and the skin glands. And what is the function of it? Involves in the protection process, isn't it? And in the excretion of the waste. The next is the skeletal system. Here the skull, vertebral column, and the limbs comes under this organ system. You know very well that it gives the shape and the form to the body, isn't it? The next one is the muscular system, which consists of various types of muscle fibers, and this helps in the movement of the body, isn't it? The next is the nervous system, and this consists of brain, spinal cord, and the nerves, and it helps in the coordination or the conduction of the nerve impulse from one place to the other. Next is the circulatory system. The organs involved is the heart, blood, and the blood vessels. Now here the transportation of the nutrition, food, gas, waste from one place to the other takes place. Next is the respiratory system, which consists of respiratory tract, lungs, and the main function is breathing. Now this digestive system consists of the alimentary canal and the various enzymes, that is the digestive glands, that is present in the whole system, and the function is the digestion, absorption, and the elimination, that is the excretion or the ejection. Next is the excretory system. The organs involved in the excretory system are kidneys, uterus, urinary bladder, and urethra. Elimination, in the sense removal of the nitrogenous waste products or the waste materials. Next one is the reproductive system. Here it consists of the testes and the ovaries. Testes is a part of the male reproductive system, and ovary is a part of the female reproductive system. Here it involves in the gamete formation and also in reproductive process. The next one is the sensory system. Sense organs, all these sense organs are involved in this system, isn't it? Eyes, nose, ears, tongue, skin, all these are the sensory organs, which is a part of the sensory system. And what is the function of it? Now since we know these are sensory organs, the functions will be the similar to it, isn't it? Sight, smell, hearing, taste, touch, all these are the functions of the sensory system. The next one is the endocrine system. All the hormones that is secreted comes under this organ system. The organs are the pituitary gland, thyroid gland, parathyroid gland, adrenal gland, pancreas,
thymus, reproductive glands, and what is the function of it? It coordinates the functions of all the organ system, because hormones is the main secretion of the hormones is the main function for this endocrine glands. So the first system that we are going to see is the human digestive system, right? The food that we eat consists of vitamins, minerals, carbohydrates, proteins and fats, and these are the complex substances, isn't it? So this has to be converted into the simple substances so that it can be absorbed and the nutrition is sent to each and every part of the cell. So there are five stages in the nutrition process, that is the absorption of the nutrition process. That is ingestion, digestion, absorption, assimilation and egestion. The process of the intake of the food, the process of nutrition begins with the intake of the food, isn't it? That is called as ingestion. Now the breaking down of the large complex substances into the simpler form using this digestive enzyme is called as the digestion. The digestive system consists of two sets of organs. The first one is the alimentary canal, which is also called as the digestive tract or the gastrointestinal tract. And this starts from mouth to anus. And next is the digestive glands, and this digestive glands consist of salivary glands, gastric glands, pancreas, liver and intestinal glands. Now let's see the structure of the alimentary canal. Now this alimentary canal is a large tube-like structure, and it consists of mouth, buccal cavity, pharynx, esophagus, stomach, small intestine and anus. Now let's see mouth. Now mouth leads into the buccal cavity, isn't it? It consists of the movable upper and the lower lip. It consists of upper and the lower jaw, beard, teeth. Now the teeth is a hard substance, isn't it? What is the function of teeth? The teeth is meant for holding, cutting, grinding, crushing of food, isn't it? And now in humans, we have two sets of teeth, so it is called as diaphodont. Now what is that two sets of teeth? One is the temporary teeth, or it is called as the milk teeth. The other one is the permanent teeth. Set of 20 teeth is called as the temporary or the milk teeth. That is the first set of teeth. Now the second set of teeth is the permanent teeth, and it consists of 16 in each jaw, so totally 32 teeth. This teeth is further divided into the types, the following types. The first one is the incisors, canine, premolar and molar. Now look into the tableau column, children. Here you can find the type of teeth, isn't it? Incisor consists of 8 teeth, and this is for cutting and biting. Canine, there are 4, tearing and piercing. 8 premolars are present, which is meant for crushing and grinding. 12 molars are present in the mouth, and this is also for crushing, grinding and mastication. Now there's a dental formula which represents the number of different types of teeth that is present in the upper and the lower jaw. Here you can see the milk teeth, the formula for the milk teeth in each half of the upper and the lower jaw. The numerator consists of the upper jaw, and the denominator consists of the teeth that is present in the lower jaw. So totally the milk teeth is 10 in the upper and the lower, isn't it? So 10 into 2 is 20, and permanent in the each of the upper and the lower jaw is 16 on either side, so it is 16 into 2, 32. Look into the picture, children. Here you can see the shapes of the different types of teeth, isn't it? And the place where it is placed in the each half of the lower and the upper jaw. Next, we'll see the salivary glands. Now, there are 3 pairs of salivary glands. The first one is the parotid glands, sublingual gland and the submaxillary gland. This parotid gland is the largest gland. Look into the picture, children. You can see the parotid gland, which is larger, right? Largest salivary gland, which is present in the cheeks, isn't it? In front of the ears. Can you look into the picture? Yes. The next one is the sublingual gland. Now, this is the smallest gland, and that is present beneath the tongue, below the tongue. The next one is the submaxillary gland, which lie at the lower jaw, at an angle in the lower jaw. Now the salivary gland secretes saliva, isn't it? And nearly 1.5 liters of saliva is secreted per day, and this saliva is useful
for the conversion of this starch into the maltase. And for this, an enzyme called amylase is helpful in the conversion of the starch into the maltose. And saliva also contains an antibacterial enzyme, which is called as the lysozyme. Next is the tongue. Now, tongue is the muscular organ and it is a sensory organ, isn't it? And this helps in the mixing of food with the saliva. And there are taste buds on the tongue, isn't it? And this helps to recognize the taste of the food. Now, pharynx. Now, pharynx is a muscular cavity which connects the mouth to the esophagus. Now, this is the pathway of the food from mouth to the esophagus. Esophagus is a food pipe. It is also called as the food pipe, and this is also a muscular membrane canal. Now, nearly it will be about 22 centimeter in length, and this helps in the movement of the food from the pharynx to the stomach, and this moves in the wave-like movement. Like a wave, the movement of the foot takes place, and there will be an rhythmic contraction and relaxation of the muscular valves of the alimentary canal, so that it helps the movement of the foot into the stomach. Now, stomach is the organ, muscular organ, that is present between the esophagus and the small intestine, and the gastric glands that is present in the inner walls of the stomach secretes the gastric juice. And gastric juice consists of colorless, highly acidic liquid or the acid, which is called as the hydrochloric acid, and it also contains an enzyme which is called as renin and pepsin. Now, here the hydrochloric acid kills the bacteria that is present in the food, and the gastric juice also consists of the liquid which is called as the mucus, which protects the walls of the stomach. Now, the action of the gastric juice in converting bolus into a semi-digestive food, which is called as the chyme, and chyme moves into the intestine slowly. Now, the small intestine is the longest part of the alimentary canal, and it goes about 5 to 7 meters, and this consists of three parts, that is the duodenum, jejunum and ileum. Now, duodenum will be in the form of C-shaped, and it receives the bile duct from the liver and the pancreatic duct from the pancreas. Next is the jejunum. Jejunum is the middle part of the small intestine. A short region, you can say, in the small intestine, and this secretes the intestinal juice, which consists of the sucrase, maltase, lactase and the lipase. Next is the ileum. Ileum is the lower part of the small intestine, and this opens into the large intestine, and ileum is the longest part of the intestine, and this consists of a small finger like projection which is called as the villi, and this villi is helpful in the absorption of the food, and this villi will be about 4 million in number, and each villus consists of fine thin blood capillaries, and this helps in the absorption of nutrition and the minerals. Now, we said that the semi-digested food enters into the small intestine, isn't it? So, this small intestine is helpful for the digestion as well as the absorption process. Now, for this, it receives the bile juice from the liver and pancreatic juice from the pancreas. Now, this intestinal glands secretes the intestinal juice. Now, let's see liver. Now, liver is the largest digestive gland of the body, which will be red in color, and this is divided into two lobes, isn't it? The right and the left lobe. The right lobe is larger than the left lobe, as we all know. Below the liver, a gallbladder is present. Look into the picture, children. Below the liver, you can see the gallbladder, which is present, and the liver cell secretes bile, which is temporarily stored in this gallbladder, and this bile is released into the small intestine when the food enters into it. When the food enters into it, the bile juice also enters into the small intestine. And this consists of the bile salts and bile pigments, and this is helpful in the digestion of the fat. Now, let's see the functions of liver. It controls the sugar blood and the amino acids levels also, and it also synthesizes the red blood corpuscles, and it produces fibrinogen and the prothrombin, and this is helpful in the clotting of blood, and it also destroys the red blood cells, and it helps in the storage of vitamins and minerals. And it is also helpful in the excretion of toxic and metallic poisons, if any. And this also detoxicates the substance that includes the drugs and the alcohol. Next comes the pancreas. You can see in the look into the picture, children, you can see the pancreas, isn't it? And this will be in the leaf-shaped gland, isn't it? And this is present between the stomach and the duodenum. And this pancreas will act both as an endocrine gland and the exocrine gland. Now, exocrine part of the pancreas secretes the pancreatic juice, and this consists of three enzymes. One is the lipase, trypsin, and amylase. And this will help in digesting fat, proteins, and starch. Next is the islands of Langerhans. This acts as an endocrine gland, and it consists of two cells, that is alpha cells and the beta cells. Alpha cell secretes the glycogen, and the beta cell secretes the insulin. Next is the absorption of the food. Now, absorption is a process in which the nutrition that is obtained after this digestion is absorbed by the villi, and it is transported to every part of the body using the blood or the lymph. Next is the assimilation. Assimilation is nothing but the absorbed food are taken into tissue cells as their internal components. And now here the final products of the fat digestion are converted into the fats, and the excess fats are stored in the adipose tissues. Now excess sugar, if any, are converted into the complex polysaccharides, and this is stored into the liver. And the amino acids are utilized to synthesize the proteins that is required for the body. The undigested food or the unabsorbed food is passed into the large intestine, and this consists of cecum, colon, and rectum. The undigested food or the unabsorbed food is thrown out, and this process is called as the ejection. So next we'll move into the human excretory system. Now the metabolic activities takes place continuously in the human body, isn't it? Now all the metabolic products are not useful for the human body. The nitrogenous toxic waste has to be excreted. Now for example, in the human being, urea is the excretory waste that has to be removed from the body. Now this human excretory system consists of a pair of kidney, ureter, urinary bladder, and the urethra. Now, if the waste materials are not removed, it will get accumulated, isn't it? And it will become harmful or poisonous to the human body. So, excretory system plays a very, very important role in maintaining the hemostatic condition, that is the for the normal healthy conditions of the body. Now, some of the excretory organs other than the kidney is the skin and the lungs, which eliminates the carbon dioxide and water vapor, takes place through exhaling. Next we'll see the skin, which is then excretory organ. Now this skin stretches all over the body in the form of a layer, isn't it? And it accounts 50% of the human body weight. Now this human body functions normally only when the temperature is about 37 degrees Celsius. Now when it becomes hot, when the temperature raises above 37 degrees Celsius, now the sweat glands start secreting the sweat, which consists of ammonia, urea, lactic acids, and salt. And this is secreted in the sweat glands. The sweat passes through the holes. Now the skin consists of minute pores, isn't it? So it gets passed out through these pores, and it gets evaporated, and which also reduces the temperature of the body. Now look into the picture, children. Here you can see the excretory system. Now what are the organs that is present in the excretory system? A pair of kidneys. You can see the right kidney and the left kidney, then the ureter, then urinary bladder, and the last is the urethra, through which the urine is expelled out by the urinary bladder contraction. Next, we'll see about the kidneys. Look into the picture, children. You can see the longitudinal section of the human kidney, isn't it? Now, this is a bean-shaped organ, which is reddish brown in color, and this lies on either side of the vertebral column, that is the backbone in the abdominal cavity, isn't it? The right kidney is placed little lower than that of the left kidney, isn't it? This kidney is covered by a layer of fibrous connective tissues, which is called as the renal capsule, adipose capsule, and fibrous membrane. Now, internally, you can see the internal parts of the kidney, isn't it? So, internally, it consists of the outer dark region, which is called as the cortex, and the inner lighter region, which is called as the medulla. Now, here both the region, that is cortex and the medulla, consist of the uriniferous tubules, which is nothing but the nephrons, which is the basic unit of the kidney, isn't it? So, it consists of nephron. The medulla consists of many conical masses, that is called as the medullary pyramids, and the inner concave side of the kidney consists of a notch-like structure, which is called as the ileum. Next is the ureter. Now, here you can see an yellow tube-like structure, isn't it? A thin muscular tubes, isn't it? That is emerging out of the ileum. So, that is called as the ureter. And this ureter carries urine from the kidney to the urinary bladder. Next one is the urinary bladder. Look into the picture, children. Here you can see the bladder, which is marked as the urinary bladder, isn't it? So, this is a sac-like structure, isn't it? You can see here it is in the form of a sac-like structure, and this lies in the pelvic cavity of the abdomen, and this stores the urine temporarily. The next below the urinary bladder is the urethra, and now this urethra is nothing but the membranous tube, a small tube-like structure which expels the urine. And there is an urethral sphincter which keeps the urethra close and open, and only it opens at the time of urination, which is called as micturition. Next, we'll see the functions of kidney. This kidney plays a very important role in maintaining the fluid and maintains the electrolyte balance in the body. For example, sodium and potassium, which is necessary in a balanced amount for our body. Now, it regulates the acid-base balance in the body. It maintains the osmotic pressure in the blood and in the tissues, and it helps in retaining the important plasma constituent like glucose and the amino acids. Next, we'll see the structure of nephron. Now, each kidney consists of numerous millions of nephrons. And what is this nephrons? Nephrons are nothing but the structural and the functional unit of kidney, isn't it? These nephrons are also called as uriniferous tubules, isn't it? And this each nephron, that is the basic unit of the kidney, consists of a renal capsule and the renal tubule. Now, here you can see the renal capsule and the renal tubule, isn't it? The renal capsule consists of a cup-shaped structure which is called as the Bowman's capsule. Here you can see the Bowman's capsule, isn't it? So, this is a cup-shaped structure which is called as the Bowman's capsule, and this consists of numerous capillaries which is called as glomerulus. Now, here you can see the glomerulus, that is the network of the capillaries, isn't it? Now, the blood enters into this glomerulus capsule through the afferent arterioles and leaves the glomerulus capsule through the efferent arteriole. Now, look into the picture, children. Here you can see the efferent arteriole and the afferent arterioles, isn't it? So, this is the capillaries through which the blood enters and leaves out. Now, this Bowman's capsule continues as an renal tubules, which consist of the proximal tube and loop of Henle. Next, you have the diastole tubule, which again leads into the collecting tubule. The nitrogenous waste are drained into the renal pelvis, which leads into the ureter, that is stored in the urinary bladder, and it is expelled through the urethra. Now, let's go into the mechanism of urine formation. Now, the process of the urine formation includes the three steps. The first one is the glomerular filtration, tubular reabsorption, and tubular secretion. Now, what is glomerular filtration? Now, glomerular filtration is involved in glomerulus and Bowman's capsule. And here, the filtration of the blood through the epithelial walls of the glomerulus and the Bowman's capsule takes place. And this filter, since it is taking place in the Bowman's capsule and the glomerulus capsule, it is called as the glomerular filtrate. And this consists of both the essential and the non-essential substances. The next is the tubular reabsorption. Now, reabsorption in the sense absorbing the essential particles, isn't it, essential substances. Now, we said that the Bowman's capsules continues into the three regions, isn't it? Continues to the renal capsule, and which consists of three regions, and one of the region is the proximal tubule, we said, isn't it? So, this proximal tubule consists of the essential substances, that is, the filtrate in the proximal tubule consists of the essential substance such as glucose, amino acids, vitamins, sodium, water, etc., and these are reabsorbed into the blood by a process called a selective reabsorption. These essential particles are selectively reabsorbed into the blood. The next is the tubular secretion. Now, here the particles such as H+ and K+ ions are secreted into the tubules, and this filtrate is finally called as urine, and this is hypertonic in nature. And finally, the urine passes into pelvis through the ureter and it reaches into the urinary bladder. And when the urinary bladder is full, the urine is expelled through the urethra, and this is called as micturition. The healthy person will expel or excretes 1 to 2 liters of urine per day. The next is the artificial kidney or the dialysis. We said that the nitrogenous waste has to be excreted, isn't it? So when the kidneys fail to expel this nitrogenous waste or the toxic waste, then it gets accumulated in the blood, and that condition is known as the renal failure or the kidney failure. Now, artificial kidneys can be used to dialyze, or you can say to purify the blood, that is called as dialysis. And the purification of the blood through the artificial kidney is called as the hemodialysis. And if the renal failure occurs, for some patients the doctor advises to go for the kidney transplantation. If it could not be treated by the drugs or the dialysis, then the patients are advised to go for the kidney transplantation. Next is the male reproductive system. This male reproductive system consists of a pair of testes, scrotum, vas deferens, urethra, penis, and the accessory glands. Now, what is testes? A pair of testes is present in the abdominal cavity of the male, and it produces the male gametes, that is called as the sperms. And an hormone is produced which is called as testosterone. And now, here the nutrition that has to be given to the sperm is provided by the Sertoli cells. That is, the Sertoli cells of the testes provide the nutrition to the sperms. Next is the scrotum. Now, what is scrotum? It is the loose pouch in which the testes are present. The scrotum consists of many nerves and blood vessels, and this scrotum acts as a thermoregulator because it provides an optimum temperature that is necessary for the sperm formation. The next is the vas deferens. It is a straight tube which carries the sperm into the seminal vesicles, and the sperms are stored in the seminal plasma of the seminal vesicles, and this seminal plasma is rich in calcium, enzymes, and the fructose. And this fructose is the source of energy for the sperm, because the sperm is movable, isn't it? It moves, it is motile, so it needs energy, and this fructose is the source of energy to the sperms. And this vas deferens, along with the vesicles, opened into a duct which expels the sperms. The next one is the urethra. Now, it is contained inside the penis, and helps in the movement of the sperm from the vas deferens into the urethral opening. And there are accessory glands that is associated with the male reproductive system, which is nothing but the seminal vesicles, prostate gland and the Cowper's glands. Now next is the female reproductive system. This female reproductive system consists of ovaries, oviducts, uterus and vagina. Now ovaries, an almond shape, ovaries are located in the lower part of the abdominal cavity. You can see in the picture it is marked ovary on either side, isn't it children? Now below the or near the kidneys, you can say in the females, and the ovaries are the female gonads. And it produces eggs or ova, you can say, and it also secretes an enzymes called as estrogens and progesterones. A mature ovary consists of large number of ovums. The next is the fallopian tubes, which is nothing but the oviduct. These originate from the uterus, a pair of tubes that arises from the uterus on either side, and at the end of the fallopian tube is the funnel like or finger like projection, which is called as the fimbriae, which lies near the ovary, and this carries the ovum that is released from the ovary and pushes into the fallopian tube. Next is the uterus, and uterus will be a pear shaped muscular hollow cavity that is present in the pelvic cavity, you can say, and it is between the urinary bladder and the rectum, and the fetus development also takes place inside this uterus, and the narrow part of the uterus is called as the cervix, and which leads into vagina. Vagina is nothing but the uterus narrowed down into a hollow tube, isn't it? So that is called as the vagina, and it connects the cervix and the external genitalia. Now with this we come to the end of the lesson children, and in this lesson we saw about the different organ system in the human beings. The first we saw is the human digestive system, and we also saw about the structure of the alimentary canal, and we saw the different kinds of teeth, isn't it, different parts of the alimentary canal, and we saw what are the different types of the salivary glands. We have learnt about the function and the structure of the liver and the different types of enzymes that is involved in the digestive process. Next we saw the human excretory system. We said that the skin, kidneys are the part of an excretory system, and we saw the functions of kidney. Next we saw what is the structure of nephron and how is the urine formation takes place, and at the last we saw the human reproductive system. In that we saw male reproductive system and female reproductive system. And your homework for today is that be thorough with the structure of neuron and the mechanism of urine formation. For that you can refer page number 240 and the function of the kidney, and the structure of kidney is also a very, very important question in this lesson. For that you can refer page number 239. So with that we end this session children. See you in the next session. Thank you.